Thank you. Good morning and welcome to our memorial service for Barbara Armstrong. I would ask that if you have any cell phones that you would please turn them to off or silent at this time. That would be greatly appreciated. I would also like to remind you that each and every person here is welcome to join the family for lunch. At the conclusion of our service here, we will go to the cemetery for an interment. Then we will come back here for lunch. There is food aplenty for all, if so you'd like to be a part of that, you are welcome. If it is difficult for you to go to the cemetery and you would prefer to wait here, you may go downstairs at the conclusion of the service and wait for those who are at the graveside service to return, and all may have lunch and fellowship together. But know that you are all invited to that lunch. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Gracious God, in the midst of life, we sometimes find ourselves in situations and places that are difficult for us to understand, comprehend, or accept. But we do know that in the midst of all these times and all these places, we are welcome to accept your presence, your comfort, and your strength. And so, Lord, I ask that you please come and fill this place. Let your Holy Spirit move freely among us. Touch each heart, each mind, and each soul. Remind us all of your grace and your love and your life that is offered to all through your Son, Jesus Christ. And in his name we pray. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 through 8. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to uproot. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search, and a time to give up. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. Amen. At this time, you are going to be welcome to participate in the service this morning. I invite you to turn in the red hymnals that are in the pew. Turn in the red hymnals, you may remain seated, and turn to page number 504. 504, as we sing the old rugged cross.
Thank you.
Barbara Driefel was born December 30th, 1936, in Paxton, Nebraska, to her parents James and Hazel Driefel. Barbara's childhood family included not only her parents, but also her brother Charles and her two sisters, Margaret and Doris. Barbara and her family moved to south of Big Springs during her youth, and she attended school in Big Springs. She graduated from Big Springs High School in 1954, but while in high school, she met a young man named Phil Armstrong, and it was a match made to last. Barbara Driefel became Barbara Armstrong when she and Phil were married September 24, 1955, at the Big Springs Methodist Church. Phil and Barbara made their home southeast of Big Springs, where they farmed for 62 years. Phil and Barbara were blessed with three children, a son Alan and two daughters, Cindy and Cyan. Barbara was an excellent seamstress, so much so, in fact, that she not only made her children's childhood clothes, but she also sewed many of the formal dresses that Cindy and Diane wore at high school dances. Barbara was an avid gardener of both flowers and vegetables. In the flower garden, she was biased toward her roses. Her vegetable garden was a big garden, and she diligently canned much from her garden each year. She was an outstanding cook, and I have it on excellent authority that if you went to her house to eat, you better arrive there hungry and ready to eat. Her chicken and homemade noodles were quite popular with the family, and she could make a delicious cake, and I'm told that she was not only a good cook, but a fine detective, because if someone tried to take a piece of cake and eat it in her absence, she could follow the clues and find out who it was that had snitched the cake. Barbara enjoyed the holidays, and one holiday that brought to service her childhood joy, her childlike joy, was Halloween. She would commonly dress for Halloween in various costumes over the years, and she would disperse whatever treats she was handing out. But she was very pragmatic at Halloween because she not only offered a sugary treat with one hand, but a new toothbrush with the other. Barbara loved to watch her grandkids, and she delighted in taking her dogs for a walk. And another favorite thing to do was to go for a ride in the pickup with Phil. Barbara's parents, James and Hazel, her brother Charles, a daughter-in-law Jeannie, and a grandson John have all traveled on ahead of her from this earthly journey. Among those left who continue to trek here without her are her husband Phil, her son Alan and his wife Nikki, her daughter Cindy and her husband Barry, her daughter Diane and her husband Steve, her sister Margaret, and also her sister Doris and her husband Dwayne. There are 9 grandchildren, 16 great-grandchildren, and as your presence here today attests, numerous other family members, friends, relatives, and neighbors who continue this path without her. Today we remember Barbara. We give thanks for the love and the life and the laughter that she has shared with you. And we pause and give thanks for the love, the grace, and the life that is ours and offered to all through our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Barbara Armstrong. I invite you to take a hymnal again. You will participate once more. Turn in the hymnal to number 314. You can remain seated. Number 314 as we sing In the Garden.
Thank you.
from the Gospel of John in the 3rd chapter. As we begin the reading today, Jesus is speaking. Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." Amen. Your final opportunity to participate in the service comes as you turn to number 707 in the red hymnal. Number 707, you can remain seated as we sing Hymn of Promise.
See, the home of God is among mortals,
He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, See, I am making all things new. Also, he said, Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. Amen. In the book of Ecclesiastes that we read this morning, the Bible tells us that in the course of our life, there is a time for many things. And today is the time for us to do some things. Number one, we pause to remember Barbara. And we give thanks for the love and the life and the laughter that we have been privileged to share with her. And we also take time to remember the love, the grace, and the life that is ours and offered to all through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as part of our taking time to remember Barbara, I mentioned some things in the eulogy that I shared with you that were part and parcel of who Barbara is. We recall that she was an excellent cook. And oh, I wish I could have had some of that chicken and homemade noodles. We recall that she liked to dress up at Halloween, and I have to tell you, I believe she's the only person I've ever heard of that would pass out candy in one hand and toothbrush in the other. I mentioned that she was an excellent seamstress, and how she sewed much of the clothes that her children wore in their youth, and how she designed and made many of the dresses that Cindy and Diane made and wore to their high school dances. And I have to tell you, girls, I'm a little disappointed. I surely thought you would wear your high school homecoming dress today. Your mother would have loved that. We recall that she loved her dogs, and she liked to take her dogs for a walk. She loved to go for a ride with Phil in the pickup, and Phil, I have it on good authority that she liked the rides best when you didn't take the indirect route to wherever you were going. She had a great love of Jesus Christ. I can tell you that as her pastor, on numerous occasions when I visited with her in the hospital or at the care center, we rejoiced together in the faith and the trust that she had in Jesus Christ. And today we find comfort and we rejoice through our faith. For we believe now that she dwells safely and securely and pain-free in the presence of God in the kingdom of heaven. So today is the time to remember Barbara and to remember those things that are part and parcel of who she is. And it is also a time for us to remember the words and the promises of Jesus Christ and of Scripture. I read from the Gospel of John in the 3rd chapter, and there we heard the Bible very clearly tell us that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. And we sang that song, Old Rugged Cross. And it helps us to remember that Jesus did die on the cross and paid the price for your sins and my sins, and so that through grace and faith we might know abundant life now and life forever in his presence. But let us be quick to note that Jesus did not say that our earthly body would not die. The Bible tells us that we will not perish, we will not cease to exist. And that when our life here is completed, through the power and the glory and the mystery of God, we can be transformed into a new body and dwell in that body in the presence of God. We sang that song, Hymn of Promise, and it helps us to remember that this earthly body is like a seed, and that when this earthly seed dies, it is transformed into something that is far more glorious and far greater than anything that we can imagine or have a right to expect. And when we sang that song in the garden and combining that with the Hymn of Promise, in my mind's eye, I saw Barbara standing in the midst of her garden. And I wondered how many times she must have stood there, holding a handful of seeds, preparing to plant those seeds in the soil, fully trusting and realizing that some way, somehow, those plants would be transformed and would grow and bloom into something far more magnificent than the human eye could vividly picture in our wildest imagination. And likewise it is for us, that this earthly seed, this body that we dwell in here, through the power and glory of God, is transfigured into something that is far greater, to which we can live and dwell in the presence of God. And then we turn to the book of Revelation. And in the book of Revelation, we are given a glimpse of what the kingdom of heaven will be like. The Bible tells us that there is no pain. There is no crying. There is no suffering. That through the power and the glory and the grace of God, we dwell safely and securely in that new pain-free body, and that we enjoy life there in the presence of God forever and ever. So today, as the Bible says, is a time. A time for us to remember Barbara, to remember those things that are part and parcel of who she is. A time to give thanks for having had the privilege and the opportunity to share life and love and laughter with her. And it's a time for us to find comfort through our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. For we fully celebrate and find peace through our faith that we now believe that she dwells safely and securely and happily in the presence of God, in a place where there is no pain, there is no crying, and she is able to move about freely in the garden of God. And we give thanks for this grace, this love, and this life that we believe is hers now and is ours and is offered to all through our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name, amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious God, we do thank you for the life that Barbara lived here on this earth. We thank you for the love that she shared with so many that are gathered here and with others who are not able to be here. We give you thanks for the words of comfort that we have heard from Scripture and through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit go with each person. May we find comfort, may we find peace, and may we find strength for the journey ahead. May all these things come to us as promised by your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name, amen. Receive the benediction. May the sun shine warmly upon your face. May the breeze blow gently upon your back. And may you abide in the presence of God today, tomorrow, and always. Go in Christ's name.